Is Tricky P in the house?
Yeah.
Tricky P, it is over to you.
Surprising. I'm going to tell you guys a little story. Hello, everybody. No, it's okay. You can turn it back up. That's fine. Your ears don't hurt, right? My folks dragged me out of bed early on a Saturday. Now I hope I could just stay home, hungover alone, and sleep a lot of pain away. But I know some nights I wish I could rewind, go back to those days I needed to remind myself just how fast these days can fly by. So I thank my lucky stars we still got some time, still got some time, still got some time. I thank my lucky stars we still got some time.
Great, thanks very much. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us here today. Tom, thank you for taking care of us here this morning. And Patrick, or Tricky P, thanks for the unique way to kick off this third public dialogue in our series this morning. Mon nom est Matt DeCourcy, je viens de Fredericton, Nouveau-Brunswick. To begin, I'm going to ask our lead presenter from the University of British Columbia School of Social Work, as well as the co-author of the Vanier Report's Young Carers in Canada, The Hidden Costs and Benefits of Young Caregiving, Dr. Grant Charles, to take us away. Thanks a lot.
Jeremy and I are going to sing our parts, so I just want to give a quick run through of young carers and what we know about them in this country. So young carers are people under the age of 25 who are the main caregiver in a family because of parental illness, disability, addiction, desertion, and who take on responsibilities beyond what would be expected of somebody that age in the family and beyond what would be expected within that particular culture. So we've been studying young carers for a few years now in BC. We're one of two research projects in the country that have been looking at these. One of the things we did, we did a survey in one of the high schools in the Lower Mainland, and we found that 12% of the kids were reporting being young carers. Now, that number, we don't know if you can generalize that out, although it holds fairly true to what's being found in Britain and in Australia, too. But a couple of things that surprised us, 50% of the people who reported being young carers were male. That's completely different than what you see in the adult population. In family caregiving situations where it tends to be the female that takes on the responsibility. And there, we saw no difference between where people were born. So ethnicity had and place of birth had nothing to do with whether or not you were a young carer. People stepped forward to help in the families because there was a need there, regardless of gender or any other issue. The other thing we did in the study was interview 50 people that had been young carers. Variety of backgrounds. I interviewed people that were homeless in the downtown east side and research scientists and everybody you could think of in between. What we saw was this is a situation that happens across class, it happens across circumstances. I mean, it's just something that happens in families. If a parent or parents have something happen to them or in circumstances where they're struggling, often the young person steps forward, a young person or more steps forward to help the family. So the themes that we saw in terms of interviewing the adults who had been young carers was an invisibility about them. I can't remember exactly, but it was a significant portion of the people I interviewed had never ever talked in their life about having been a young carer. Many of them were in tears talking about it because they'd been holding on to this thing for 5 years or 10 years or more. Almost all of them talked about a lack of support. And a lack of acknowledgement of from the outside system. You know, stories of young people going to parent-child interviews about their younger siblings and the teacher or principal not saying, where's mom or dad? You know, it was just, the situation was invisible even when it was completely obvious. The two other themes were protection of family privacy and family preservation. So every family has a strong need to stay together, and that's what young carers are doing, is trying to keep the family together. The privacy is a big issue. A lot of young people are afraid that if what's happening in the family gets to be known, then child protection will come and break the family up. The other issue that comes up is this whole false maturity or premature maturity, is that a lot of the young people have to grow up too fast. We know that one of the number one predictors of wellness in adults is school achievement, and these kids are all vulnerable on school achievement. A lot of them do okay, but they're vulnerable there. And that leads into unemployment and employment issues later on. We see higher levels of depression and anxiety. On the positive side, though, we saw higher levels of compassion and empathy being reported, higher tolerance of others, a real sense of pride in terms of what they've done, a sense of selflessness that is unusual for adolescents. Not that adolescents can't feel that, but this was higher. And repeatedly a closeness to the person they had to care for. So this was an ongoing positive experience and an ongoing negative experience at the same time. So we have this wonderful resource of people that really are skillful in many ways that we waste because we don't support them in the role. I don't think we can just stop having young carers. That's an outcome of circumstances in families. But we can support them better so that they can stay in the family and do stuff that's age appropriate. We're light years behind the UK and Australia in terms of what we do in terms of practice and policy. And I'll stop there.
Since my work in recent years has been in an inner city context, I thought that I was well aware of all of the important issues that directly impact a student's educational, social, and emotional well-being. Yet when I read Dr. Charles and his UBC colleagues' Vanier report for the first time, I quickly realized that I too had never properly recognized these young people who were enrolled in my schools and who remain virtually invisible amidst the throngs of talking, laughing, interacting peers who had the privilege of being full participants in everyday school life. I was especially surprised because I had worked with support and counseling teams in my schools to implement case management models so that all at-risk children would have at least one adult in the school to oversee their particular case. My associates and I were obviously aware that some children did not attend school on a regular basis, were frequently late or tired, had not completed homework assignments, or were underachieving because of the home situation. Frequent cases of older children looking after younger ones did come to our attention, and yet we never clearly identified these children as young caregivers per se. As a result, the focus remained more on the parents and their needs than on the children who had been playing such a key role in keeping the family together. If lifelong inner city educators like myself are only marginally aware of this emerging issue, we can easily understand how others still remain uninformed. I thank Dr. Charles and his colleagues who are working so diligently, and all the others who are working so diligently to bring about greater awareness of the plight of this very special group of young people. So today I have been asked to focus on two questions primarily. Who should care about young caregivers and why? In general terms, in a country like Canada, where we pride ourselves on helping those in need, most people would probably care if they were aware of the situation. And I'll be more specific about the who a bit later on. Without a doubt, a strain on young carers at one point or another will have an impact on their schooling, on their ability to keep up with assignments and to attend school on a regular basis. One specific example I dealt with was with a lovely 12-year-old young lady, the oldest of four, who stayed at home to look after her newborn baby brother when their mother, who had struggled with addictions for many years, would go back on the streets of downtown Eastside to look for drugs. Without the help of this older sister, the baby might not have survived. He might not have survived his first year, in fact. But this very capable student barely passed her grade 7 courses because of frequent absenteeism. Everyone agrees that the number one predictor of academic success and of high school completion, which is the bare minimum that students must have these days for any kind of employment, the number one predictor and the number one need is regular attendance. My hope is that a broader advocacy group, perhaps a multi-agency provincial body, will emerge as a result of today's dialogue. And the other thing that I think that we should do, that the advocacy group could do, is to lobby local, provincial, and federal politicians for the kinds of policy and legislative changes that will recognize young carers legally and provide the protection for their educational, social, emotional, and physical well-being that they need and deserve. In terms of the rights of the children, I would really be remiss today if I did not mention the most vulnerable, invisible, and unprotected group of children in this country. And these are the First Nations children living in reserve communities and attending band-run schools. The education of First Nations children is federal and not provincial jurisdiction. So these children have no real education system. And the only legislation in place for them, with a few notable exceptions where modern tripartite agreements have been signed, is the obsolete Indian Act of 1876.
Our current child welfare legislation, of which I'm one of the authors, provides plenty of scope for providing services to young carers and their families, but unfortunately is not always interpreted that way. I think, though, going back again to what Tricky P was telling us at the beginning, we often don't understand our own hidden assumptions about what's happening in families. We don't understand the context that's happening for young carers. And that context includes a very broad range, as he laid out for us, both from the perspective of the desire to help, the fear of what that helping leads to, as well as the risk to the regular activities, fun, enthusiasm that you might have as a young person. And I think that the institutional response to that has to be creative enough to reflect that entire range, and that's very, very difficult for institutions to sort out. It's not easy to craft a legislative or policy response to a situation that is as changeable and as unusual as some young caring situations can be, again, because so much of it is based in relationship or fear of involvement of the state or fear of the unknown. Not all young care relationships are based on, of course, as Grant has pointed out, are based on circumstances of goodwill. Sometimes there are families where there is, in fact, danger and risk for young carers in the sense of being forced to look after caregivers, parents, who may not have the child's best interests at heart. And we need to figure out what response is required from the state to adjust to all of those kinds of situations. So what's the answer to that? I think the answer actually, and I think Carolyn hit on this very, very well, I think the answer is a culture of caring that recognizes what it is that people are bringing to school or to the institutions that are providing services to them, to understand what the underlying story is. And that's really, I think, the way to rebuild the sense of relationship that needs to happen for these young carers, to know that somebody else is there in their corner when they need help, because they certainly don't need help all the time, but when they do, we'd better be prepared to step up.
So as I mentioned, we're going to move into 15 minutes of small group discussion, and I believe we have three questions that we want to focus on. I'll ask a representative from the group to stand or sit, I guess, at the microphone and in 30 seconds provide maybe the one salient point or the one issue of interest that was discussed within your group. Do you want to start that?
We came to the question, are we trying to support people in these roles or are we trying to change the situations that we're in? The second prong that we focused on was, how do we raise awareness of this issue coming from the perspective that most of us were not aware of it before it came up here and in this context?
We talked a little bit about the right for privacy and the sort of tension between what information can be shared between various professions within a school system was one of the examples.
We really thought that awareness was number one, but also a multidisciplinary and systemic approach to the problem, including making referrals for young carers to get support, and underlying all that is understanding who the young carers are and what they need, so more research.
We also talked about how it's much easier for a youth caregiver in a situation like a parent being sick or dying to have connection with the communities around them than for a student or a youth caregiver who is dealing with a parent who has something like a drug addiction or whose mother is a prostitute, something like that. It is much more of a social stigma associated with that sort of thing.
I'll ask Patrick for comment as well.
That works. The most important thing is if you are, you know, a young carer and you're giving up that much of your life to help your family, because family is really important, but the most important thing is that you realize you were doing something very good that a lot of people couldn't handle. So be proud of yourselves and thank you very much for having me out.